part of the year. And there are times when we have.
But after I saw the player,
we recognize that $6 an hour is just not enough for Cayman to survive on.
And it's over.
I'm sure your listeners can imagine it is quite easy. Good afternoon, Cayman Islanders, and welcome to another episode of the Resh Hour with yours truly, Reshma Raghunath. Thank you for tuning in this afternoon. I am very pleased to welcome Governor Jane Owen to our studios for our final show for the year, Governor. So thank you very much for being our season ender.
Thank you very much for having me, and wishing everybody a very happy festive season.
Lovely, thank you. So we have a lot to get into, Governor. So I want to start first with some of the news of the day. And I'm talking about the budget, and that was recently passed in Parliament. So first of all, let's talk about the budget process and, you know, some of the concerns that came out of it about the expenditure from government and the massive borrowing, $150 million. So first of all, you know, is this something that you are equally concerned by?
Well, I think the clearly the Cayman population continues to grow and our challenges continue to grow, and so I guess in many ways it's not that surprising that our expenditure continues to grow. And as I look around the world, in the UK, in Europe, in the US, all countries really I think are struggling with some of the same issues about how best to use money wisely and how to prioritize when we have so many priorities that we need to cover off. Budget is not something that is in my direct responsibility, but obviously I work closely with the government, particularly with an eye on the FFR agreement. That's the framework for fiscal responsibility, mm-hmm. which is the agreement that we have between the United Kingdom and all of our, or most of our, overseas territories, and we certainly have one with Cayman. So I have been making sure that the budget, in the way it's currently constructed, is fully within the boundaries of that framework, which I'm very pleased about.
Okay. Now, I know there was discussion under the previous premier talking about maybe looking to change some of the parameters of the FFR. Have you had that kind of conversation with our new administration or our new premier?
Well, we haven't had it in a great deal of detail with anybody yet, including the previous government. It's something that we, you know, if we thought it was necessary to have that sort of conversation, mm-hmm. we would certainly do so. Cayman has a really strong reputation for prudent and good budget management. So I think if there were to be any changes, that would be done in a very careful and considered way. But as I say, at the moment, with the budget planning that we have before us for the next 2 years, we are in any case planning to remain within the boundaries of the FFR. So at the moment, it is not not an urgent conversation to have, if you see what I mean.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. Now, during the budget debate and then thereafter Finance Committee, the governor's residence came up as part of the questioning and the conversation by parliamentarians. And one of the concerns was access to the government residence and also maybe moving you to a different location for residence. Have you had that conversation, and, you know, what's your take on that?
Well, I haven't had detailed conversations about it with the Premier or indeed the government. I know it is a view that is held by some people, including some people in Parliament. I guess it would be a very big sort of political decision, you know, to mm-hmm. to change the governor's residence that's been there for so long. I feel very, very privileged to be in it. And I regard it as really, really important that it is an entity that is there to be used and to be used to the benefit of our government, of our different organisations, of the people, and I'm working very hard, as indeed I've always done in, you know, in previous jobs where I've lived in a residence, to make sure that we're making the best use of it, best value for money, and the most open and effective use of it. So that's one of the things that I will definitely continue to do. And I hope that people who have come to the governor's, my residence on Seven Mile Beach, will find that it's a welcoming place, it's a beautiful place, it's quite a special place, and therefore I think it's a great asset for Cayman to be able to have and to keep. And it's very, very different from all of the other assets that we have on Seven Mile Beach.
Mm-hmm. Would you be willing to move? I mean, it is a gorgeous sunset every day, right?
Mm. Well, I guess it would probably be a decision that would need to be taken between the government of Cayman and the government of the United Kingdom. And of course, whatever decision was made, I would accept that and go along with it.
Okay. Now, staying with Parliament, you delivered your very first throne speech
yes.
in Parliament. So tell me, what was the feeling like for you delivering your very first throne speech in Parliament?
Yeah, it felt like a real honour and a very special moment for me. And it was also an opportunity in the run-up to it to think hard. I wrote the throne speech myself. And so it was a chance to think hard about, you know, what I wanted to say, looking back and looking forward, and thinking about the overall relationship and what it means, thinking about the way in which I take forward my own responsibilities, but also work very much in partnership with the government. And that was one of the things that I really wanted to come through very clearly, is that we work in partnership, we talk about priorities and what we're doing, and we do agree them, so that when things are going forward, the relationship that Cayman has with the United Kingdom can then be a nurturing one and a supportive one for whatever the government is aiming to do here, which I think is the case.
Mm-hmm. Now, in your you have officially marked 8 months in the island,
yes.
and that kind of capped off the tenure for the year, right?
Mm.
You tackled a number of issues in your throne speech, and specifically you talked about crime,
mm.
which of course naturally is a major concern for
mm.
the community, and security falls under your direct remit
mm.
as well. So can you talk to us a little bit about the crime situation and the plans going
mm.
forward?
Yes, so I've really enjoyed working with our new police commissioner, Commissioner Walton. We have a very good relationship. We also work very closely in partnership. I rely very strongly on his advice and strategic guidance. I think he has an extremely good balance between looking at the strategy for the longer term, but also focusing every day, every week, on what sort of policing do we need to have on the ground. How do we work with our communities? How do we prevent crime as well as respond to it? So that's an incredibly important relationship for me. I know that people in all across the island have probably been concerned about whenever we have a spike in either violent crime or violent robberies, it's really, really important to respond to that quickly. And I do think that's something that Commissioner Walton has done and will continue to do. We have to have a mix of having the police out there on the streets, in the community, talking to people, sharing information, combined with what goes on in the back office, if you like, the mm-hmm. forensics and that kind of thing, where we have an increasingly effective response, I think. And the other thing we've tried to do, including through the National Security Council, which meets each month, is to figure out how we can best join up all across government, because particularly if you're thinking about prevention, but also enforcement, you know, you have to be talking to the people doing the work permits, people doing the customs, the airport, the prison, the education system, the healthcare system. Mm-hmm. It really is everybody coming together to think about what are the best strategies we can have.
Mm-hmm. Now, part of getting into the fight of crime is the community trust, and that bridging that gap between police and the community and being able to come forward with information. Are you seeing that relationship between the community and the police strong in that sense, where people trust the police to come forward with information?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying it's perfect. I don't think it is in any country. And certainly, you know, my experience looking at what goes on in the United Kingdom as well, I think where you have issues of trust, you need to really work hard to try and create a better situation. I'm really impressed that the police go out into the community. We try and get a good deal of consistency about police who are out in the different areas of all three islands. So we probably need to do more on that. But it's an incredibly important part of what we do. And as I said, it's very important for the prevention. So it's not just the police going out in the community and talking about the latest crime, it's also going out and talking to the schools. You know, it's talking to the doctors and the clinics in a gentle and a caring way to watch out for those people in our community who might be feeling vulnerable, who might be facing a choice in their life, and to make sure that we are giving them the support, maybe offering them a job opportunity, rather so that they have got choices.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know this year we did see an uptick in gun-related crimes. Mm. We saw a number of firearm-related robberies as well. Is there a game plan from the commissioner to clamp down on firearms? You know, we've heard in the past talk of gun amnesties, you know, and in some cases it didn't really work to get the new weapons out on the street. But talk to us a little bit about, if you can, about the plan to deal with firearm-related crime.
Yeah, I think we need to look at it from all of the different stages. We need to look at the import of firearms, both through the airport but also and the port, and also just illegally on small boats, for example. So the maritime environment, the sea, is very important to that. We need to make sure we've got the right forensics, the right security systems to start with in all these places, and we have been upgrading that, which I think is very good. But then also having very good forensics to follow up in the aftermath of any sort of gun crime, which we do have. We have a really effective forensics and ballistics lab, and that is being incredibly helpful to us at the moment. But you're right also to talk about the community and information, because I wonder, and this happens in every country, you know, if people are aware that, you know, a gun is being kept somewhere, the problem is you never know when that gun is going to be accessed and used, do you? And if it's there, you've always got that gun is available kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So just sharing that information can make such a big difference, because if the gun is not there, you're really helping to prevent a crime, and maybe to prevent a crime from being a lot worse than it could have been.
Absolutely. And also, you know, you never know, that gun could be used where in the commission of a crime where one of your relatives may inadvertently or innocently be at the wrong place and the wrong time, kind of thing. So that's why it's always important to give the information when you can.
Yeah, and I think, you know, I think everybody does have a very clear understanding, don't they, that here in Cayman we are actually so lucky that our environment is relatively so safe, and it is recognised around the region, and we need to work very, very hard all together to keep it that way, because it, you know, it protects our lives and our well-being. It protects our mental health. It gives us more opportunities for, you know, jobs and economic development. It protects our tourism industry. It's so important to every. It protects our children, for goodness sake. You know, it really protects them and what their future will look like and what their opportunities will be. So it is so important that I do see security permeating every aspect of life and policy here on Cayman.
Absolutely. You know, in your throne speech, Governor, you did also touch on another, hot topic or topical issue here in the community, and that is road safety as well. Mm. We are in the holiday season. Mm. We do know that people will be celebrating, and we've seen consistently on a daily basis multiple collisions, simple fender benders to more serious collisions. Mm. And you noted this in your throne speech as well. Is there any sort of extra vigilance that will be coming to address this as we look at the holiday season?
Yes, definitely. So I think the vigilance is coming from two directions, actually. One is obviously the police, who are looking at the enforcement, and there definitely is a big push to have more police out there doing traffic policing. But also, I've been really impressed that, for example, in the civil service, we've got the Arrive Alive campaign. I think that was done by individuals in the civil service, but they're probably supported by a lot of people outside the service as well. So that is really, really important, because I think unless you've got the buy-in from all of us to recognize that you do need to have a designated driver, that is the way forward. And it's not okay to be using your mobile phone. And I think very often, and the statistics show this, it's not always the younger people who are the culprits here. It's quite often people who are, you know, 50, 60 years old. It's, you know, it's sort of my peers who are probably the worst at this. Just check your phone, or, you know, have that extra glass of wine. And we just have to, or rum, probably even better. We have to recognize that's not okay, because you're putting your own family and friends in danger, and you're putting a lot of other people in danger as well.
Absolutely. And of course, there is the Purple Ribbon Pledge.
Yes,
that's also
the one.
On.
Yes, yeah. That's the Arrive Alive.
Exactly, the Arrive Alive.
I love that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, you can get transport, so you know, you don't have to drink and drive. Mm. And I think that has been a consistent campaign, especially during the holiday season, to ensure public safety, but also personal safety. Mm. And I know the Compass is also involved in that as well.
Oh, that's great. Thank you very much for doing that.
Absolutely.
Really appreciate the support.
So, you know, we touched on it before. You are in your eighth month as governor. So I want to talk to you a little bit about that experience. What has it been like for you? And how does it compare to your previous postings?
Yeah, I think no comparison possible, really. I mean, it's just so wonderful having the opportunity to live here and to meet so many of our great Caymanians in all kinds of different walks of life. Everyone has been so helpful, giving me advice, telling me stories, making sure I can understand as much as possible about the islands. And of course, I need to do a lot more of that. I've really enjoyed working with the government. I love working with Honorable Wayne Panton when he was premier, and now it's really great working with our new premier. And with the whole of cabinet, I think it's great to see the sort of priorities that the government is grappling with. I think they are the right priorities, and so it's a great privilege to be supporting them in some way on all of that agenda.
Mm-hmm. Now, you touched on our new premier. This her ascension to premier came with quite some excitement, for want of a better description. I'm sure you were not expecting that kind of political upheaval when you came across. Can you talk to us a little bit about what that was like? You were away at the time when the no confidence vote was triggered.
Yeah, I was. I was in the UK at the time. I think I always felt confident that Cayman has an effective democratic system. It's very clear. The constitution is clear. The procedures are clear. And we were able to follow through with those procedures. So, you know, there was never any sense of panic or great upheaval. I think it was just a question of seeing how the discussions that needed to be had would come out and what would be the result. And, you know, my role as governor is to work with the majority of the parliamentary representatives if they can form a group together as a majority. And that was all, I was always very clear that that was what I intended to do.
Were you taken by surprise by all that unfolded while you were away?
Well, I think, you know, politics is always a surprise. You know, they have this phrase, don't we? A week is a long time in politics. And I think, you know, a week is a long time to predict what will happen in politics anywhere in the world. And it's certainly, you know, it's true that if you're in a democracy, you can never completely guarantee what's going to happen, you know, next month, next 6 months, whatever. But what you can guarantee and make sure you've got is a firm, fundamental bedrock of systems and processes in place for how you go through the motions of whatever happens. And I think we proved yet again in Cayman that we have very good systems in place.
Was there ever any risk of the UK intervening here?
Well, I don't know what you mean by that, really. I mean, the UK would not, you know, intervene in Cayman's political process. It's for the democracy here in Cayman to take its course, and that's what happened.
Okay. Now, we do have two ladies in the top posts in the country now. Mm. It's not something that happens every day. Mm. What has that been like, you know, sharing a female premier now?
Yeah, I mean, I think we all just sort of take it in our stride. It is fantastic working with Premier O'Connor Connolly. We have a great relationship. We talk a lot. I have huge respect for her. I think she's very organized. I think she's very clear about what she wants to do. I think she's a great communicator. I really enjoy working with her. It's also interesting that our Chief Justice is also Margaret Ramsay Hale, and of course, you know, Catherine Ebanks Wilkes was until very recently yes. in another very senior post, and as a woman, and it's, you know, and it's been great to also welcome Alden McLaughlin, the Honourable Alden, into that role now as well. So I think it shows, doesn't it, that in Cayman we're in a position that whatever your gender, you know, hopefully you can live your life according to your merits and your ambitions and your service to the community, and that's the same for men and women. I often think, you know, because I've got two kids and one's a boy and one's a girl, you know, I think it's really important also to make sure we kind of look after the boys as well. Yeah. We have to have a good balance.
Absolutely. Thank you for reminding me about our Chief Justice, Miss Margaret. I apologize for forgetting you in the top three. So, you know, Governor, as part of your role, you are also quite involved in the community, and you've been on the ground during your 8 months. Do you have any specific plans over the holiday season to continue that tradition? Are you going to do any traditional Caymanian Christmas dinner? Tell us about the plans.
Yes, I think I'm planning on cooking a turkey. I'm not sure I'm brave enough to try and do Caymanian style beef, but I'm hoping to actually try some that somebody else has cooked, which is probably a much safer way forward. So looking forward to that. Last night I was driving around enjoying some of the beautiful Christmas lights. Thank you very much to the Bodden sisters, all three of them actually, who welcomed me into their home and showed me around their wonderful display. So it's been very nice to do some of that. And I also went to visit the Pines Retirement Home also yesterday. So it was great to see some of the residents and some of the visitors who were there, and to see this wonderful facility that we should all be so proud of here in Cayman. Tomorrow I'm going to Cayman BRAC, which I'm looking forward to. So going to the BRAC again to take part in their Christmas celebration tomorrow night.
Yeah, there's no place like Cayman when it comes to Christmas. Mm. I mean, the holiday spirit, the lights, it really is a truly lovely experience. Are you staying with us for Christmas?
Yes, definitely, yes.
Oh,
yes.
Nice, yes. Good. All right, so Governor, we are going to take a quick break to check in on the headlines and the weather. We are welcoming the wonderful Christmas breeze. So we're going to do a quick check-in on the weather and our headlines. And on the other half of the break, I want to talk about the UK relationship and how we are moving forward with this process.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much.
Stick around. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Thank you for staying with us here on the Resh Hour. We continue our conversation with Governor Jane Owen. Governor, when we were before we took the break, we were talking about Christmas in Cayman and you know, the celebrations. I want to take the conversation now to the UK relationship. We did recently have the Joint Ministerial Council in the UK. Did Cayman have representation there? Because I know that happened kind of, it not deliberately, but it kind of fell in the time where we had the change in administration.
Yes, I think all was good because Cayman was represented by Dr. Tasha Ebanks, who's the representative in London, and she did that very ably. She's well networked. She understands very clearly all of our priorities and the important topics that we wanted to make sure were covered on the agenda. So I think that was, it was a great meeting.
Okay, now during that meeting there were a number of declarations that were made. Can you take us through some of the key declarations that our overseas territories leaders agreed with the UK?
Yeah, so I think there was one main declaration which I've actually got here in front of me, which we call the Joint Declaration of Governments of the United Kingdom and the British Overseas Territories. So this was a kind of quite a high level document, if you like, which sets out our desire to continue to build this very effective British global family, if you like, or global family that we all share. And it went into some detail about what are the important elements of making sure that this relationship is balanced, it's successful for both sides or all of the sides. It recognises the sort of responsibilities and obligations that both sides have to support each other, and it looks at some of the important areas that obviously we want to continue to focus on in the future, whether it's security or crisis response or building our economies or looking after the environment, or indeed looking at the wider global international picture and figuring out what does that mean for the overseas territories and how can the UK support the overseas territories as a, you know, one of the only five countries in the world that are on the UN Security Council, for example. I think having that heft of the United Kingdom is, I would hope, really helpful to Cayman and our fellow overseas territories.
Mm-hmm. Now, coming out of the JMC, the leaders agreed to move forward with discussions for a new compact.
Yes.
That was very significant, you know, a second look at the relationship. And we've seen in the UK Parliament, two MPs in the UK have been asking for various select committees looking at the relationship with the UK and its overseas territories. Has that discussion begun on what the new compact or agreement would look like for the Cayman Islands?
I think it's quite early days, but I've spoken to the Honourable Premier about this, and I think we're both clear that we would like to start talking about the compact pretty early on, so we're definitely up for a discussion about it. And I think it will be an opportunity for us to think about how can we make this relationship as substantive and secure and useful for the future. So we would want to cover all of the areas that have come through in the declaration, and of course it is for Cayman and the UK to add anything else they want to that. I think it may take obviously a little while to negotiate the compact, and that's quite right, and we should take our time and we should do some proper consultation. So I should be, you know, enjoying having some discussions hopefully with in future over the coming months with your listeners as well, mm-hmm. to sort of understand what is important to our population here in Cayman.
Absolutely. I know when we did the review of the Constitution a couple of years ago, part of the discussion was the removal of Section 81 in the Constitution, and that is the governor's reserve powers. Will that form part of the discussions as well?
I think, you know, I think everything is on the table. I think what we need to, I mean, I don't know how that discussion would go, but if you think about it, it's a kind of, you know, the whole relationship is a balance. And as I mentioned, it is kind of a balance of the obligations and the responsibilities. So I think you have to be a bit careful about not deconstructing it to such an extent that then you start to think about, well, what does this relationship mean? What does it mean for both sides? So it mm-hmm. would be a very, very big question if you were going to do that, because then that would speak very much to the UK's obligations and responsibilities and some very deep things that are very meaningful to the UK in terms of the relationship. But there's certainly no reason at all why you can't have that conversation.
Mm-hmm. Are there any like key areas that you would like to see broached when the conversation begins?
Well, I think, you know, some of the things that are in the declaration are absolutely vital. So, you know, it's really important that the UK is, for example, continuing to give Cayman the support it needs in relation to crises and hurricanes and that sort of thing. It's really important that we continue to work together on security. So, for example, we have had some Royal Engineers from the British Defence Forces out giving training, not just to our regiment here, but actually to all of our uniformed services, you know, the police and the fire. So I think, you know, there's a lot of value that can be had from having that relationship. Talking about the economy, the wonderful financial sector we have here, how we can make the most of that as a sort of force for global good, if you like, because it is helping to finance so much of the development around the world. That's really important. Making sure the UK is fulfilling its obligations in terms of consulting the overseas territories when we enter into international treaties or mm-hmm. agreements. That is another thing that was in the declaration, was saying we're going to get better at having that sort of consultation. And then, of course, you know, talking about how we best protect the environment. We've just come out of the big COP climate mm-hmm. UN meeting. How we can work on that successfully so that we have a balanced approach which takes into account what Cayman wants to do with its economy and its development, but making sure we do that in the right way. So I think there's an awful lot of things we can talk about.
Absolutely. You know, you touched on it there. Climate change is a big part of the UK and UK's agenda, and as well a part of the governor's office as well. We had the COP decision calling on all nations to transition away from fossil fuels to achieve net zero by 2050. It's a very ambitious goal. How do you see Cayman factoring into that?
Yeah, I think, you know, we've got the climate strategy, we've got an energy strategy, we'll have a development strategy. So all of these things will need to look long term, won't they? But I feel that all of the different organisations and entities in Cayman, including, for example, CUC, are clear that they want to engage, they want to make a plan, they want to think about how best to do this, because obviously they are best placed to tell us technologically and in engineering terms what is feasible, how are we going to do this, and of course very importantly how much is it all going to cost and how are we going to finance it. But I'm, you know, I think one of the emerging feelings that is coming out from the international community, from big countries, medium countries, small countries, is that climate, it's not really change anymore, it's just the reality, isn't it? And we have to deal with that reality. And one of the things, I've spent a lot of my career working on trade and investment and commercial issues, and I am so clear that the opportunity, the commercial opportunity to make money out of green technologies and solutions is massive. And the opportunity for all of our kids to get jobs doing this, for all of our IT people to find the solutions that we didn't know we had, you know, 2 years ago, it is the big opportunity. It is the next industrial revolution, and we're already living it, and we have to get on board with it.
Absolutely. Is that going to be part of your plan for next year? What's your agenda looking like for 2024?
Well, I think, you know, working with the government on some of the priorities that we've already set, supporting them. But yes, I think, you know, I think security is important, environment is important, supporting the economy, working together to build up our financial sector and the great contribution it makes internationally, which we've seen through coming off the FATF grey list, through the work we're doing on beneficial ownership, for the work we're doing on sanctions. You know, you can see that all of that will continue to be very much in the headlines as we go into the next year.
Mm-hmm.
And also, you know, I know that any of our politicians, both in the government and on the opposition bench, I know if you ask any of our honourable representatives in Parliament, they will all say that cost of living, looking after our community, finding the right solutions to support all of the people in Cayman is a huge driver for all of us, and that's entirely right.
Mm-hmm. Now, we touched on your term earlier, and you know, the community interactions. Are you going to be visiting the sister islands more often next year? Because, you know, they often say that the sister islands sometimes get forgotten in the conversation too. So are we going to be seeing you heading off to Cayman Brac and Little Cayman more often as well?
Well, I guess I have to see how the how my timetable goes, but I've loved visiting the sister islands. I've been to Little Cayman twice, been diving there, really loved it, looked at quite a lot of the public facilities and so forth there as well. I've been to the Brac twice now as well, and I'm going again tomorrow. Also been fascinated by everything I've seen there, you know, whether it's the parrot walk, the beautiful beaches, the asphalt plant, the hospital, the water plant, the electricity plant. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Brackers, for showing and introducing me to all of this. On Little Cayman, I met a whole bunch of people who are making ropes, which is so fascinating, isn't it?
It is.
Beautiful. They are really beautiful, actually, the modern ropes that are used. And it's such a skilled job to make
Absolutely.
Them even today, isn't it? So, yeah, I'm hoping to maybe go to, when I'm in Brac tomorrow, I hope we have some singing and dancing. Honourable Premier, if you're listening, we need singing and dancing. so let's see how that goes tomorrow night.
Well, one thing I can tell you, Cayman Brackers are quite talented. So I'm sure you're going to get quite a good show tomorrow
yes,
when
I
you
hope
go.
So.
All right, Governor, unfortunately, we have run out of time. The conversation goes so quickly here, and you have been so gracious, answered all of my questions, which I appreciate. You know, we did just have hurricane season. I know, you know, it was kind of a quiet season,
yeah.
A good one. And the UK ship was also... also on island, also in the region, sorry.
Yes.
And it was quite a successful... tour of the Caribbean. They took some drugs away and and stuff like that. You know, just any parting thoughts on hurricane season?
Well, I think it's so important, isn't it, for us all to be prepared. We're very, very grateful to everyone here on Cayman that works so hard to make sure that we are well prepared. So whether it's Hazard Management Cayman Islands or the Red Cross or the Regiment or all of our emergency services, people all across government who are working on it, the Weather Service, you know, we are well prepared, and we've tried to do a lot of communication to make sure that every household is also well prepared. And I think people are responding to that really well. It's hard, isn't it? Because if you go for a couple of years and nothing happens, then you have to just keep reminding yourself how important it is. But I know that everybody in Cayman, a lot of you out there have experienced very bad weather over the years. And so you know how important it is. Mm-hmm. And the UK will continue absolutely to support that in whatever way we can.
All right, wonderful. Well, Governor, any final thoughts as we wrap up Christmas, our Christmas episode?
Yeah, for a better description? I guess to wish everybody a very, very happy Christmas. I hope people get a rest. I know that not everybody gets a rest, so we're very grateful to all those people who are out there working and serving the community, even during the holiday days. I hope people are being able to spend it with their family, with their friends, spend some time talking to loved ones who are maybe not on the island as well. Hope that kind of fellowship and that message of hope and community really shines through, as it always does in Cayman. And I'm so looking forward to continuing to share this time with a lot of your listeners as well. So thank you very much for having me, and happy Christmas to everyone.
Thank you so much. We appreciate that, Governor, and we appreciate you taking the time to be with us today. And we look forward to seeing you in the new year.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
All right. Well, that's our show for today and also for the year. It's our final episode here of the Resh Hour. And as we go, I will not give you an inspirational thought this time. I will give you a very personal Christmas message from us here at the Cayman Compass. On behalf of myself and Director Andrel Harris, we want to thank you so much for joining us here on the Resh Hour throughout the year. A big thank you to the Governor and all of our guests who have been with us here on the Resh Hour. And to our viewers, thank you so much for your kind support. We look forward to seeing you in the new year. May your holiday season be filled with peace and joy, and a very Merry Christmas. Happy New Year from us here at the Cayman Compass. Have a good afternoon.